Hello and welcome to session 233 in the AISafety.com reading group. Tonight we'll be discussing a document called AISafety.com, written by me. So I have been. My name is Søren Elvelin. I have been organizing this reading group for 5 years, and over that time I've been giving 200 presentations at least. In my day job, I've been working as a software developer, and I have a background in computer science. This document is about my plans for what I intend to do from now on, because I have quit my job, and I want to focus on making a startup for aligning narrowly superhuman models. And I want to talk today about some of my plans for how I will go about that, and in particular, what I hope to accomplish with this, how this will be efficient, effective in helping solve the alignment problem. All of this is, of course, subject to change in that these are my plans for now, and I haven't started on actually doing this yet. To zoom out a bit and give some background on the alignment problem, there's a quote by Henry Ford that what people would ask for is a faster horse, but in fact, he gave people a car because cars in the for engineering and biological and physical and cultural reasons, cars and wheels are far more practical than improving horse legs. In a similar fashion to this, people have been asking for a robot butler of this kind since the dawn of artificial intelligence and even before. And that also turned out to be, in practice, very hard to build. So the people who built AIs built something different, something that is perhaps not quite as well-intentioned as we'd hoped a butler would be. So we do have some rather powerful AIs now, and I'm going to focus on language models right now. Language models are famously unaligned. They don't love you. They don't hate you. They want to play a game. And with language models, often the game is to complete some kind of prompt. The problem that makes this worse is that these language models are growing substantially more powerful, picking up new abilities at a rather alarming pace. Nick Bostrom has the analogy for technological development with drawing balls from an urn, in that every time we get a new technology, we're gradually picking up balls from an urn representing new technologies, and perhaps some of these are black, meaning that they could potentially be an existential risk. So we've gotten quite a few reasonably nice white balls lately. We can now do image recognition and protein folding, and of course, it's not either we can or we can't. But we're gradually getting these kind of new technologies from the urn. But we do know that there are black balls on the urn. Nick Bostrom has identified 6 cognitive superpowers that could be used for potentially very negative things. And we are picking up new balls and hoping we won't get a black ball. In my rough, very rough estimate, it seems like if I had to give a number, I would say there are 200 white balls or something like that. So if we grab a new white ball like every couple of months, there is a substantial risk we will end up with one of the black balls within a decade or so, to give an idea of my timelines. There is, however, one ball inside this urn, which I've painted gold, and that is the technology of AI alignment. AI alignment has the potential to not just be another good thing, but be a thing that completely invalidates this. A potential a superintelligence that is aligned is still scary, but far less scary, and there's a good chance that this would be the solution that we are after. Nick Bostrom says that what we are looking for is differential research progress, some way of grabbing for the golden ball instead of grabbing for a potential black ball. So right now that can be visualized as some kind of race between the people working on alignment. I've just put a mirror logo here, and people working on capabilities. I have put an OpenAI logo here, which is perhaps somewhat unfair in that they also do alignment work. It seems hard to improve on this. I would love to do foundational research in the style that Miri does, but I've long since discovered that I don't have the taste for it. And trying to slow down AI capabilities in general seems even less tractable. But there is another option, and that is that right now we have language models. Here's a transformer, and we don't know how to align them, but this seems like a much more fruitful avenue for progress, to try to align language models. It would both be progress in the sense that we don't know how to align any language model towards any goal, and if we could robustly align it towards one goal, then even if that goal is not our ultimate goal, that would still be a substantial step forward. The second is epistemic, in that we expect that getting practice at the thing that we want to be good at eventually is likely to be very helpful. It will create some kind of feedback loop that is, in science in general, really valuable. So there's a golden ball in this urn, and I make another claim about this ball, and that is that this ball is eminently valuable. That if we had a way to robustly align large language models, that would potentially be very, very valuable. So to spell it out in, I'm going to read this. Current or next generation large language models are superhuman in executing a large subset of current business processes, but are held back by insufficient alignment. So this is the core statement that I have built this entire idea around. I realize that a lot of people would not believe this, would believe that it is mostly a capability problem. Paul Graham has a quote where he likes to say that when you build a startup, you need to have something that looks like a bad idea for other people, but that you know are true. And of course, I would love to prove this in a rigorous formal way. I don't think I can do that, but I can at least explain some of the intuition behind this. I will build a business around this with the following business model. I'll start by taking some of the existing alignment research, perhaps doing something new, and I will use that to align a large language model. Now, often when people talk about alignment, they mean either it's aligned or it's unaligned. But in my view, alignment is much more gradual. It is certainly meaningful to say this model is 1% more aligned than another. You would probably need to specify that a bit more, but I do believe that we can reach a more aligned model. This aligned model is, according to my statement, able to do some of these business processes better. And this is, of course, a claim that I will need to substantiate. When I have done this, the next step is to capture some of this extra value that will be created. And hopefully I'll be able to funnel this back into more alignment research, allowing this cycle to continue and grow and eventually turn into something that can be really helpful or even a full solution to the alignment problem. But that's, of course, very optimistic. Let's start with the concrete alignment research and how I see that as different from the or what I see can be done with a concrete model that you can't do in the total abstract way. So in the document that I've linked, I've described 12 concrete tasks that I think can be done when you have this model and that doesn't require this very idiosyncratic way of thinking that is characteristic of the current alignment organizations. The three I consider most promising are, first, some kind of prompt hacking. And this is, of course, a thing that has a bad reputation in that we we are probably reasonably sure that this will not be the full solution to the alignment problem. That would surprise me very much. But I also believe that this is certainly a way to get more aligned models, and more aligned models will help us immensely in the coming time from here on until the alignment problem is solved. The second is something like OpenAI's microscope, where the microscope is mostly used for visualizing and image recognition, but I believe that something quite similar can be done for concepts and alignment-relevant concepts. The third is treachery, which I believe is far easier to investigate given a particular model. The obvious way this would work out is that neuroscientists have discovered that there is a neuron inside your brain that corresponds to Halle Berry, and maybe we can find a neuron in a neural network that corresponds to treachery. That would, of course, be a very substantial amount of progress if that turned out to be possible. So, if we have a large language model and we try to make it through business processes, why is it an advantage that it is more aligned? The first thing, when you analyze business processes, you think this is basically just capability. So what are business processes? Business processes are things like, they are often split into three. There's the operational business processes, there are supporting business processes, and management business processes. I'll focus here mostly on the operational. These are things like you have a company that receives an order from a customer, and then they need to produce something, and then they need to invoice them, and they need to do customer support, handle the warranty claims, all these kind of things. And when you look at what are the actual things that happen in the informational side of office work, it's often things like forwarding emails, figuring out answering
really simple questions,
manuals, or some kind of thing.
Data entry, or just putting things in more structured formats, or looking things up from simple lists, and all
these kind of
really simple tasks that it seems some of them can be automated, and some of them have been automated. And
many companies have automated a substantial fraction of their business processes.
Those that are not yet
automated are typically ones dealing with language or human judgment. And GPT-3 can do basically all of these simple business processes. There are it probably cannot do it out of the box. You will need to fine tune it somewhat until before it can do these things. But it seems quite possible. This doesn't seem like it requires some far off technology. But the question here is, if this requires a bit of human judgment and a bit of language and nothing more, then in theory it should also be possible to do by someone who only have a high school education or something like that. Something a very unskilled person. My claim here is that actually trying to do these business processes is a lot more complex than they seem. There's a quote I like from a famous Japanese swordsman, in that all these small tasks that you do, they need to always be focused on the actual goal that you want to achieve. For sword fighting, it's cutting the opponent, and for businesses, it's making money or similar business goals. And back in the 90s, there were a wave in Denmark where a lot of businesses tried to just fire all their people working on these kind of business processes and moving everything to India, and then hiring the cheapest people in India they could find, and then not really training them or onboarding them or doing anything. And that predictably failed horribly, because you cannot do this. In understanding these business processes and doing the things required very often requires some broader understanding, some broader experience, some broader context, some broader understanding of what are the actual goals, and how does this part that I'm making, how will this small brick that I'm making be a part of a huge cathedral. And people have tried to do this better, and many of the other non-operational business processes I talked about are indeed ways to get around this problem, to have some kind of governance structure to ensure that things are aligned with each other. There's an old joke, probably from, I think it originates in Dilbert, in that many companies have too many meetings, and they should just have sent an email. And of course, many companies have tried to just have fewer meetings. They're not that stupid, but they've realized that all these meetings are in fact necessary to ensure alignment between different people and different parts of the process. So getting a bit deeper into how this business alignment works, you can analyze this in many ways. Here's one way that I think is productive, and that's to see you have an employee and you have some business processes in a company, and
this employee is implementing these business processes, but implementing them imperfectly.
If you try to put it back into language models, you are very likely to see, if you try to train on, for instance, the actual emails that are being sent, then you're not going to see the business processes as an object, but you're going to see people's ideas about these objects. And getting from here to here and getting this kind of alignment is likely to be difficult. There is also like a principal agent problem. This is something that's been discussed a lot. The employee have interests that differ quite a bit from the company. The employee would like to have as high a salary as possible, whereas the company would prefer the salary to be low. The employee would like to be irreplaceable, to hide information, which the company doesn't really want. And finally, the business processes don't necessarily correspond directly to the goals of the company. There are some way, in order to formalize business processes, you have to dump down reality, to go on a level of abstraction that is necessarily too high. You can't capture all the details. There are many other ways you can decompose this. There are, of course, multiple employees, how they work together, how departments, a large company needs departments, creating even more problems for aligning these departments. Where precisely these alignment problems are more problematic, and where the problem is more on the capability side, is an empirical question. I consider it open, and it could depend on many things. I do have some theories about this, but this is something that I will need to investigate, and the way we will probably investigate this as a startup will be things like trying this in different settings and see where extra value is created. Right. So that was the first we had some alignment research leading to more aligned models, and now, given that we can create some more business value from this, how do we capture this value? I realize, of course, this is hard, and I don't want to pretend that I have all the solutions for this, but I can sketch a few things that might give us an advantage. So the first is, as far as I can tell, we do have a first mover advantage in that. The alignment part is not one that I see other people are doing. And in general, with startups, there is a first mover advantage. We would prefer to be the last mover, but the first mover advantage is something. My model of how many language models will be available and will be more powerful is that this number will shrink dramatically as the AI race heats up. And I expect OpenAI, DeepMind, there will be some Chinese, and there probably will be some three-letter agencies in the United States that have these huge, huge models, but there won't actually be that many. And that will also create a market that will not be perfectly competitive. If we do pre-training and we start early with that, we will at some point have a language model that understands a lot about business processes, and that is a kind of moat, as the startup concept of a moat, something that prevents other entrants and allow us to capture more value. It's not a perfect moat, but it's not nothing. And finally, alignment researchers who are prone to working on this, I have an idea for capturing, for cornering the market, you could say, about this, and I'll explain that in a bit. There are also other challenges. Getting to the market, that is also a really hard task. We do have some advantages that I hope will make this easier. The first is that our marginal costs are very low. Running a training something like GPT-3 is really, really expensive. Fine-tuning it is cheaper, but not certainly not free. But the marginal cost of actually using it is very low. And we will, given that my hypothesis is right, we can in fact offer compelling value at a very low price. So this seems like it might be possible to grab a substantial part of there is a large total market for this kind of business aligned business processes, but there will be challenges, in particular in the beginning, and some flexibility will be required. Not quite throwing spaghetti at the wall and see what sticks, but we will need some flexibility here. The last part was, given that we have captured some of the value that these models are creating, how can we use that to get more research? Now, on the first approximation, you would think that would be an obvious question, right? You have money, you want research, you hire researchers, finished. That has, in fact, turned out to be quite problematic for foundational conceptual research. Miri doesn't know how to spend the money they have. They are unable to really scale up. And in my analysis of why this is that Miri-style research needs a certain way of thinking, I've used the old word grokking concepts, which is not just a mathematical understanding of the concepts, but a specific way of thinking that needs to overlaps with rationalism and altruism, and also requires a large degree of cultural fit to be able to work in these kind of organizations. On the other hand, if there is a model within the looking glass here, I expect that a lot of these cultural things will be much less required. In this case, if you have a model and the model is doing X and you would like the model to do Y, then you can basically hire a skilled AI researcher and put that person to work on that problem directly without having to do this very complex onboarding thing that Miri needs to do and that they can't scale up. So I believe this can scale up dramatically by being done in a mainstream setting. Finally, some words about how I intend to structure the ownership, because I intend to do that in a... let me see if I can move this away. I can't. So here's an example of how I would structure the ownership, the final ownership. So 1/3 of the equity I have earmarked to selling off gradually in order to grow faster. So these are just some random numbers for seed funding and a series A, B, C, mostly just random numbers. And the second third of the equity will be given to early employees, central employees, and particularly interesting employees that we want to grab a hold on. So this is, compared to most other companies, this is a rather large fraction. The last third is even more interesting. That is something that I intend to counterfactually assign after the alignment problem has been solved. Remember, the entire point of this is to solve the alignment problem. And if we don't solve the alignment problem, then this won't be very necessary. But if we solve the alignment problem, then one third of the company equity will be awarded to the people who have contributed to the actual solution, because that's what we actually want to have people working towards. Another third of this third will be awarded to more broadly community-based effort. When I try to dig down into what this is mostly alignment research that doesn't end up working out. But it's also community building in a bigger sense, like arranging conferences and deconfusing and talking with people, getting credentials, all these kind of things. The last third is contributing to the financial success and the growth of the company, in that if we expect that the actual impact of this will be in the alignment research, then having the money to hire alignment researchers is a key thing. And the people who contribute to this will be awarded corresponding to counterfactually how much their contribution has been. The idea with this is that I'm not optimizing for making myself rich or anything like that. I'm optimizing for having the as much growth as possible in order to attract people who are attracted by this kind of thing. There are of people who are totally perfectly altruistic can already find other ways of contributing. But I believe that many more people will be able to contribute if there is some kind of both direct and expected payoff from succeeding on this problem. Another advantage is that until the problem is solved, I maintain 51% ownership, which will allow me to resist any kind of pressure to dilute the mission of solving the alignment problem. And of course, there will be substantial pressure to do things like, oh, let's take the most capable model that we have, because that will allow us to earn more money. And I want to be able to say, no, that is too dangerous, and put the mission first. So given that the focus is on the mission, an option would be to make this a non-profit. And in theory, I would like that, because on the goal is, as a non-profit, to solve the alignment problem. But after that, I intend to we have a business that is potentially very valuable, and that will be distributed out like this. And so it's only a temporary nonprofit, and I'm quite sure that this is not a thing that is recognized by the legal systems or the tax systems or whatever. I have a meeting scheduled with John Burton on Monday. Maybe I'll get more into this. This is all somewhat vague for me, but that is at least my hope. So the original idea for this was very much inspired by Ajay Kotra and her work on elaborating the case for aligning narrowly superhuman models. She does have a section about objections to why this would be effective. She raises these objections and answers them herself. And I appreciate that very much. I think this is really good work, and this is what has inspired me. So thank you, Ayaya. In her work, she talks about people who are in a position where they can start research projects without any need for external funding, and how they can contribute to this. And the idea of putting this as a part of the business model of a startup is mine. And we'll see. I'll start in roughly 2 weeks, and then we'll see if I can actually make that happen. That is all for tonight. Thank you, and see you next week.